Chapter 9, Section 5, Solving Quadratic Equations by Using the Quadratic Formula. This quadratic formula is another one of those key concepts you're going to be hearing and seeing all along throughout the rest of your math career. You're going to be using it a lot. Completing the square of a quadratic equation, ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0, produces a formula that allows you to find the solutions of any quadratic equation. This formula is called the quadratic formula, and yes, that is a vocab term. Key concept says the solutions of a quadratic equation, ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0, where a is not equal to 0, are given by the quadratic formula, which you can see over here to your right. It says that x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all divided by 2a. Obviously, somebody who had a lot of time on their hands or was very smart discovered this little formula, but it comes in handy for trying to find the solutions to these things. And it says you're going to derive this formula lesson 10-2, so don't worry about that right now. We'll have more time to weep over it later. Solve x squared minus 12x equals negative 20 using the quadratic formula. The first thing we're going to do is rewrite the equation in standard form. To do that, we're going to take that minus 20, add 20 to both sides, and now we have it in standard form. Next, we're going to apply the quadratic formula to it. Quadratic formula, of course, states, as we said, x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all divided by 2 times a. And that needs to be the first thing you write on every single problem of your homework. We're going for a little rote memorization here. You got to know this thing. Oh, we did a little skipping. Hold on just a second. Alright, that's better now. Now you can see we took our b value of negative 12, plugged it in the two places for b. We took our a value of 1, you had 1 x squared, put it in for the two a spots. And we put our c value of 20, and we put it in for the c spot. From there you're going to do your math. You've got to take your negative 4, your 4 plus times 1 times 20 gave you 80. Then your negative 12 squared gave you 144. Then we're going to take 144 minus 80, and that's going to give us a square root of 64, otherwise known as 8. Now remember, this plus or minus is carrying all the way through with it. So at this point you got 12 plus or minus 8 divided by 2. Now you're going to have to break it down into a couple different sides. Either x equals 12 minus 8 all divided by 2, or x equals 12 plus 8 divided by 2. That's coming from this plus or minus thing right here. It's either a minus 8 or it's a plus 8. From there, 12 minus 8 is of course 4, 4 divided by 2 is 2. 12 plus 8 is 20, 20 divided by 2 is 10. So using the quadratic formula, you can find the solutions of the equation. Well, this quadratic equation are going to be 2 and 10. And while this is a fair bit of work, isn't it a lot easier than solving by graphing? I mean, how much easier is it to do that than to have to find your axis of symmetry, your vertex, and then points on opposite sides of the parabola enough to make it and figure out what your solutions are? Very good way to solve quadratic formulas. Let's get this out of the way here. The solutions of quadratic equations are also not always integers. We talked about that yesterday, and you had to make that evil table. Excuse me, a couple days ago, you had to make that evil table where you broke it down into tenths to estimate how close you could get. And I think we will all agree that that was a very painful process. Quadratic formula can make it easier. Solve equations by using quadratic formula, round to the nearest tenth if necessary. This one's already in standard form, so we don't have to change it. We're going to take and say, well, for this equation, your a value is 3, your b value is 5, your c value is negative 12. Write your formula, substitute your values in, and you can see everything's color-coded to make it easy for you to see what they did, and then work on the simplifying. 4 times 3 times negative 12, or negative 4 times 3 times negative 12 is positive 144. 5 squared is 25. 25 plus 144 is 169. Square root of 169 is 13. And here you break it down to two separate problems, either negative 5 minus 13 divided by 6 or negative 5 plus 13 divided by 6. That's going to end up giving you either negative 3 or 4/3 for your final answer. And notice 4/3 is not a integer. It is the same thing as 1.3 repeating. It's going to continue on and on forever. And if you were to take and work that out the way that you were taught in the lesson we did the other day, you would have had to make that table. Now, I just noticed something. What does this instruction say? Round to the nearest tenth. What did your textbook say? They did not change it to a decimal and round to the nearest tenth. So let's take a minute and do that right here. We're going to take and add another screen on here. Copy current question. And we're going to write in our pen. And so this one here is going to equal to 1.3. And we'll even go ahead and circle that as well. Easy math. Here's another problem of the same general type. They give us this nice little quadratic equation. This time, however, the problem did not come to us in standard form. So the first thing we're going to have to do is we're going to have to make it in the standard form. So to do that, we're going to take and subtract 25 from both sides, giving us 10x squared minus 5x minus 25 is equal to 0. Now we're in standard form. We got our a value, our b value, and our c value. And we're going to apply the quadratic formula to that. Of course, our b value is going to be negative 5. So you hit a negative negative 5 here, which then it cancel each other out. Our a value ended up being a positive 10 right here, and our c value a negative 25 right here. From there, we're going to do our simplifying. Negative 4 times 10 times the negative 25, that's a pretty big number, that's positive 1,000, plus 25 to that, and you get 1,025 right here. Square root of 1,025, that's a little bit tough. You work that one out, instead of working that out straight up, we're going to take and break it down like this. 5 minus the square root of 1,025, or 5 plus the square root of 125. Now the reason we went ahead and just carried these down as a square root of 1,025 on each of these spots is because 1,025 is not a perfect square. So it would get to be pretty tough to carry all those numbers, those decimal places down. It's a lot easier just to carry down square root of 1,025 on either side. From there, you could use a calculator. I'm not going to fault you for a calculator on these. 5 minus the square root of 1,025, which ended up being, I believe I found 31 point something when I did that. And then you took that number, divided it by 20, you got negative 1.4, or positive 1.9 as your two solutions, rounded to the nearest tenth. Once again, isn't it a whole lot easier to use a quadratic formula than it was to take and use that table of the tenths that we did the other day? A little study tip here. In example 2, the number 1,025, square root of 1,025 is irrational, so a calculator can give you an approximation of its value. So the exact answer of in example 2 is 5 plus or minus the square root of 1,025 all divided by 20. the numbers 1.4, negative 1.4, and 1.9 are only approximations. Whether it's because this is an irrational number, you cannot get an exact answer. So if you want the exact answer, that's it. That's as close as you can get to writing an exact answer, mathematically speaking. These other two values, the negative 1.4 and the 1.9, those are merely approximations of what the exact answer actually is. You can solve the quadratic equation by using many different methods. No one way is best, it says. Here's another one. Let's try it. You got the original problem, x squared minus 4x plus 12. We're going to place it in standard form by subtracting the 12 from both sides. So take your original equation, subtract the 12, and now we have it in standard form. After we do that, we establish our A, B, and C values. And then we're going to this one says to graph the related function. I guess it wants us to do it different instead of using the quadratic equation the way we have been. So let's see where this takes us. In fact, in this approach, we're actually going to take this same exact problem of x squared minus 4x equals 12, and we're going to beat this horse so many different ways. We're going to do all the different techniques we have already learned to do. Starting off, of course, with the graphing. To solve it by graphing, remember you had to use that formula, negative b over 2a, to find your vertex, or your axis of symmetry. Then you use that value to find your vertex. You pick points on one side of the vertex to find out what one side of the parabola is going to be. And then you would take and line that up to pieces on opposite sides of the axis of symmetry. Real easy, but painful. I'll agree, there's a lot of work. Remember, you locate the intercepts of the graph from there. At this point, the intercepts are negative 2 and 6. You can see those at that point here and here. So your solutions were going to be negative 2 and 6. You could also take the same exact problem and solve it using factoring. To solve this equation using factoring, we would have taken and placed it in standard form again. And this time, we would have recognized that, what exactly do we have here? Well, we've got this little factored out problem that said x minus 6 times x plus 2 is equal to 0. And they would have done that by making that table of different factored products and sums that we learned in the last chapter. From there, you would use the zero product rule, either x minus 6 equals 0 or x plus 2 is equal to 0, finding that once again x is 6 or x is negative 2. Another way you could have done this is by using the completing the square rule that we learned in lesson 3, I believe, maybe 4, not lesson 4, yesterday's lesson. To complete the square, we're going to take the original equation. We're going to say the equation is in the correct form to complete the square, since the leading coefficient is 1 and the x squared plus x terms are already isolated. So we don't need to place this in standard form. You leave it in this form for using the completing the square process. From there, you're going to take and use the negative 4 over 2 all squared. That negative 4, of course, came from this value right here, your b value, and that ended up equaling 4, so we added 4 here and we added 4 there, and in doing that it gave us x minus 2 all squared is equal to 16. Take the square root of both sides, x minus 2 is equal to plus or minus 4, therefore you had x equals 2 plus or minus 4, x equals 2 plus 4, or x equals 2 minus 4, and there you have the same solutions again of 6 and negative 2. Lots of different ways to skin this kitty cat, or beat the horse, depending on how you want to do it. And then the method we've learned today, using the quadratic formula. Take your same problem And this time we're going to take and put it in standard form again. And then we're going to acknowledge what our A value, B value, and C values are, and we're going to plug them into the quadratic formula, negative B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4AC all divided by 2A. Plug those values in, simplify, and then you get your final solutions of negative 2 and negative 6. So we've got four different approaches now for solving quadratic formulas. You are going to have to know all four of these approaches. You're going to have to be able to show me on a test all four of these approaches, so please be familiar with them. Concept summary: solving quadratic equations. You can take and use factoring. When we use it when the constant term is zero, or if the factors are easily determined. Not all equations are factorable. Graphing, we're going to use that when an approximate solution is sufficient. Using square roots, we use when an equation can be written in the form ax squared equals n, and can only be used if the equation has no x term. Completing the square can be used in any equation ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0, but it's simplest to apply when b is an even number and a is equal to 1. And the quadratic formula can be used for any equation in the format of ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. So the quadratic formula is kind of the catch-all. It does all of them that's in that format, or some of the others are a little iffy on when you can and cannot use them, or shouldn't use them. The discriminant. In a quadratic formula, the expression under the radical sign of b squared minus 4ac is called the discriminant. The discriminant can be used to determine the number of real solutions of a quadratic equation. Once again, that's a vocab term. Know it for your quiz. Using the discriminant, if you have an equation such as x squared plus 2x plus 5 equals 0, when you plug it into the formula, the quadratic formula, your discriminant value ends up becoming negative. So you have a negative 16 there. Notice when you graph that equation, you have zero x-intercepts, so there are no real number solutions. Your solution is going to be theta, the empty set. If, when you plug these values into your equation, your discriminant equals 0, you have one x-intercept on the graph, so you only have one solution, or otherwise known as a double root. And if, when you plug your values in for your equation into the quadratic formula, you get a positive discriminant, that tells you that you're going to have two x-intercepts, and it's going to look kind of like this right here. You have two real number solutions. To state the value of the discriminant of 4x squared plus 5x equals negative 3, then determine the real number of real solutions in the equation. All right, so we're going to take and rewrite it in standard form, 4x squared minus 5x plus 3 equals 0. From there, we're going to find the discriminant. To do that, we're only going to focus on the part that's underneath the radical sign. If you remember, the part underneath the radical in the quadratic formula is b squared minus 4ac. And when we focus on that, plugging in our b, our a, and our c values, what do we end up getting? We end up getting a negative 23 for our discriminant. So how many real solutions do we get with a negative discriminant? Zero. Since it's a negative discriminant, there are no real solutions. Your homework for this section is page 587. Numbers 16 through 48 and 63 through 71 odd.
You ever notice how winding your window down by hand makes you look lower middle class? There's a cheap way to fix that. First of all, what you want to do is get the window winder right off there. Throw that away. Next, get yourself one of these battery-powered mixer, hand mixers, that units here. You ever notice on these how the blades go in opposite directions? Remember that. I'm going to be referring back to that later on. These are real cheap, especially if the blades are missing. Okay, now to wind the window up, all I do is stick one of these blade receptacles over the window winder shaft and then just hit the button. How do I wind it down? Well, after that reversing direction thing comes in that I was referring to earlier, I just pop that on.
And you